Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Tenant by Katrine Engberg. Translated by Tara Chase. Read by Graeme Malcolm.
Wednesday, August 8th. Prologue. The morning light swirled up dust from the heavy drapes. Gregers Hermansen sat in his recliner and watched the motes dance through the living room. Waking up took him so long these days that he almost didn't see the point. He laid his hands on the smooth, polished armrests, tipped his head back, and closed his eyes to the flickering light until he heard the final sputters of the coffee maker in the kitchen. After a brief countdown, he got up, found his slippers, and shuffled toward the linoleum floor of the kitchen. Always the same route, along the mahogany cabinet, past the green armchair and the damn hand grip on the wall that the aide had installed last year. "I'll do fine without it," he had insisted. "Thanks, anyway." So much for that. In the kitchen, he tossed the used coffee grounds from the machine into the trash bin under the sink. Full again. Gregers untied the bag, and supporting himself along the table as he moved across the kitchen, he managed to open the back door with his free hand. At least, he could still take his own trash down. He looked askance at his upstairs neighbour's collection of bottles on the landing. Esther de Laurenti, one hell of a drinker, who held loud dinner parties for her artist friends that lasted late into the night. But she owned the building, so it was no use complaining. The steps groaned under him as he held on tight to the railing. It might be more sensible to move somewhere safe, to a place with fewer stairs. But he had lived his whole life in downtown Copenhagen and preferred to take his chances on these crooked stairs rather than rot away in some nursing home on the outskirts of town. On the second floor, he set down the trash bag and leaned against his downstairs neighbour's doorframe. The two female college students who shared that unit were a constant source of irritation, but secretly they also stirred in him an awkward yearning. Their carefree smiles reawakened memories of summer nights by the canal and distant kisses, back when life wasn't yet winding down and everything was still possible. Once he had recovered a little, he noticed the women's door was ajar, bright light pouring out of the narrow opening. They were young and flighty, but surely not foolish enough to sleep with their back door open. It was 6:30 in the morning. They may have just come home from a night on the town, but still.
"Hello?" he called out. "Is anyone there?"
With the tip of his slipper, he cautiously nudged at the door, which easily opened. Gregers reflexively recoiled a little. After all, he didn't want to be accused of being a dirty old peeper. Better just pull the door shut and finish taking out the trash before his coffee grew stale and bitter upstairs. He held the doorframe tightly and leaned forward to grasp the handle, but underestimated the distance. For one horrible, eternal instant, like when a horse throws you until you hit the ground, he realized he wasn't strong enough to hold his own body weight. His slippers slid on the smooth wood parquet and he lost his balance. Gregers fought with all the strength he no longer had and fell helplessly into the women's apartment, landing hard on the floor. Not with a bang, but with a thud. The pathetic sound of an elderly man's diminished body in a flannel bathrobe. Gregers tried to calm himself with a deep breath. Had he broken his hip? What would people say? For the first time in many years, he felt like crying. He shut his eyes and waited to be found. The stairwell fell silent once again. He listened for yelling or footsteps, but nothing came. After a few minutes, he opened his eyes and tried to get his bearings. A bare light bulb hung from the ceiling, blinding him, but he could vaguely make out a white wall, a shelf of pots and spices, against the wall leading to the door, a line of shoes and boots, one of which he was surely lying on. Carefully, he turned his head from side to side to check if anything was broken. No, everything seemed intact. He clenched his fists. Yes, they felt okay too. Ah, that damned shoe! Gregers tried to push it out from under him, but it wouldn't budge. He looked down and tried to focus his eyes on it. The uneasy feeling in his stomach swelled into a suffocating paralysis that spread throughout his body. Sticking out of the shoe was a bare leg, half hidden underneath his aching hips. The leg ended in a twisted body. It looked like a mannequin's leg, but Gregers felt soft skin against his hand and knew better. He lifted his hand and saw the blood. On the skin, on the floor, on the walls. Blood. Everywhere. Gregor's heart fluttered like a canary trying to escape its cage. He couldn't move. Panic coursed through his impotent body. I'm going to die, he thought. He wanted to scream, but the strength to shout for help had left him many years ago. Then he started to cry. Chapter 1. Copenhagen police investigator Jeppe Korner splashed water on his face and looked at himself in the mirror on the tiled bathroom wall. This particular mirror was concave and stretched his face tall and thin, while the one over the next sink stretched it wide. He always forgot which mirror did what until he was washing his hands. Today it was the concave, making him resemble the figure in Edvard Munch's painting The Scream. Suited him just fine. He was looking tired and knew it wasn't just because of the energy-saving bulbs used by police headquarters. The silly, peroxide-bleached hair didn't help. He should never have let his friend Johannes talk him into it. Variety is the spice of life. Ha! Maybe he should just shave it all off. Then at least he would look like a policeman again. Jeppe made a face at his own reflection. It was like every other newly divorced guy in the books. Classic. Next step would be to find himself a regular pub to hang out in, buy a sports car, and wear his pain on his chest like a badge of honour. Maybe even get himself a nice scar, a knife wound to match the scars he bore on the inside. He dried his hands on the rough paper from the dispenser and looked for the trash can, crumpled the paper towel and took a shot. It hit the floor with a limp, wet smack. Perfect, he thought, leaning to pick it up as nimbly as his sore back would allow. I'm one of those guys who misses the shot but is too duty-bound to leave a mess. He pushed open the bathroom door and headed down the hall toward his office, self-loathing flooding through his body. With its three-sided, neoclassical structure, Copenhagen Police Headquarters lent authority to its neighbourhood, situated just blocks from the ever-blooming Tivoli Gardens amusement park. The building's exterior, cold and unapproachable, was a smug beacon of power and integrity in the heart of the Nordic country's liberalism and nonsense, a much-needed counterweight to free pornography and record-setting alcohol consumption. On the inside, the famed circular colonnade of the inner courtyard and 19th-century Italianate craftsmanship softened the impression a little. Beautiful mosaics and terrazzo flooring brightened up the work days of the police staff, lying under their harried footsteps as a reminder of times when the workplace had to reflect the authority of the police force. The homicide department had been left in its original somber state, with vaulted ceilings and dark red walls lit up with sconces. Practical modern furnishings clashed with the walls' flaking paint, giving an overall impression that was equal parts dilapidated and forced. The office Jeppe shared with his colleague, Anette Werner, was no exception. Filled with sad laminate and moulded birch furniture, and lacking any ambition whatsoever to create a cheerful work environment. Anette, on the other hand, provided just that. As he walked in, she was reclining in her chair, feet up on the desk, laughing at something she was watching on her cell phone.
"Korner! Come see this," she said. "It's incredible."
"Morning, Anette," Jeppe said from the doorway. "I thought you had class today."
"You just won't give it a rest, will you? The DNA class isn't until next."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.